My Father, we come before you again this evening to give you thanks for all your blessings and all your corrections, Father. And we thank you for this opportunity to meet together and to learn and share about your word, Father. So we give this lesson into your capable hands to arrange everything that is being said and done, and to open our hearts to receive everything, to learn, and to be able to put it in practice in our own lives.
That's right.
We thank you, yeah. Father, and we give you praises and glory in Yahusha's name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, sister. And it looks like we're doing a duet tonight. It's just you and I. Hallelujah. Where two or three are gathered in his name.
Yes, we are here.
And so I appreciate you. And I appreciate, you know, Brother Shem and Sister Rita and Anna and those others that I know that tune in at a later time at their convenience. Mm-hmm. You know, we live in such a world where our pace is not always consistent, you know. It's so, like you mentioned before, you know, technology is awesome because this is where we can, you know, we can have it towards our advantage, right? So finally we are back on track. This to me is exciting. We were journeying through the Overcomer Promises to the Seven Assemblies. And if you've been tracking with us, then you will be able to see all the uploads on Yahuah, Our Delight. And we did go on a little bit of rabbit trail, a detour, because we thought that there was some pressing information that we should really be awareness of, right? So, and you know, there's no organized structure in a sense. We just, you know, I love how the Ruach can just lead us to where we would, you know, where the Ruach would lead us and guide us, right? So tonight we're going to continue our journey, and this is to the Overcomer Promise to the Ephesus Assembly. The Ephesus Assembly, the Ephesus, I've heard they are known to be, like, that word Ephesus means darling. Isn't that beautiful? Darling. And that picture I have on the screen, I think it's mesmerizing, don't you, sister? It's like either it's, I don't know if it's sunrise or a sunset, but it is beautiful. And did you want to perhaps read? There's only a few chapters, and perhaps I have on the screen Revelation 2:1, and maybe we can read all the way to 7.
Okay. Awesome. Can you? Okay. I have Revelation 2:2 on the screen. Oh, 2:1. Okay. Yes. To the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things says he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who works in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil. And you have tested those who say they are apostles and are not. And have found them liars.
Yes.
And you have persevered, and you have patience, and have labored for my name's sake, and have not become weary.
Yes.
Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love.
Wow.
Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent, to do and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent.
I love that. I'm just going to move here so that you can all. Here we go. Verse 6.
But this you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of Yahuah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, sister. Do you know, just by reading that, the first seven verses of Revelation 2, you and I and those who are listening to this have just received a special blessing from Yahuah. That's what Revelation chapter 1 has stated, and we will claim it. So thank you for reading that. And, you know, there are a number, like I've mentioned in the past, there are a number of teachings, beautiful teachings, more in-depth, comprehensive teachings when it comes to Revelation, especially the details and the construct of these letters that Yahusha himself wrote. For our purposes here, I wanted to simply use the last verse here that you read, verse 7, because I want to take this opportunity and bring this back. We're now going to go back to Genesis, right? And I think through this, we have all of these, what seems to be poetic and imagery, and you wonder why, you know, what does Mashiach mean when he says, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of Yahuah, right? So all of these things, I think, when we just take the time to go back and just unearth what the first few chapters of Genesis has for us, it's just amazing. I mean, I started, when I started to write down, and I guess some would call it put your brain on paper. I started doing that. And I have a little bit of rant that I'm going to just read because I think it's pretty profound here. And I've mentioned this in the past, but also, you know, why do we, or why do I seem to be gravitated towards the story of the Genesis story? Like, why am I always kind of going back there? And so I propose that, you know what, the Genesis story is the core story. And I have mentioned in the past that it really has some underlying foundation of some serious questions that we all must consider, or I think by innate in us, you know, questions like, who am I? Where did I come from? And why am I here? What happens after this life, right? So these are some serious questions, and, you know, serious enough that people don't really, I don't know if you find it, my sister, but you don't really see a lot of people go there nowadays because we have such a busyness in life, like unprecedented. I think we've never been so busy before. Do you agree?
Yes.
Right? And I think a lot of that is the social media as well. And, you know, the rate at, you know, the Twittering and all of these, you know, everything that's going on. And I find that our minds don't have the capacity to entertain such serious questions. And for the most part, we'd rather, you know, because it's the easiest route, to stare at our screens, you know, put on the movie, Netflix, whatever, get in the alpha state brainwave, this relaxing state. And really, we've become the world's coping mechanism. It's become the world's coping mechanism to the daily stress that we face in life every day, almost everywhere we turn, right? And these really, we don't realize, but these are toxic stress that we face for the most part. We really it's self-imposed. It's by choice, and we find that it's cyclical, right? And what's happened, sister, is we've become desensitized to these prison walls that we have. You know, and to a point, I believe, and this is my rant when I was putting this together, I believe that we have these prison walls to a point where we prefer incarceration, to a point where walls are no longer necessary. Why? Because we have learned to be helpless. You know, we really believe in, you know, and unknowingly, maybe we, you know, one hearing this right now will probably we'll have to think a little further on what I'm talking about and maybe have to reevaluate life in general. But I think for some part of us, we think that we are free, right? And, you know, this is the mode of thinking that we have. But there are some people that I'm going to quote, and they have some pretty interesting comments to make, like Henry David Thoreau. And this is along the line of what I'm kind of proposing, is that Henry is saying people think they are liberal and free. And he says it is the freedom of a prison yard, right? The world is a prison, by Karl Kraus. The world is a prison in which solitary confinement is preferable. And for us to understand what I'm trying to point before you is that we have to on a daily basis, we have to evaluate our life. Like what is it that the Ruach HaKodesh, that the spirit is showing us, right? Because, you know, we sort of get into this tolerating mode. We tolerate for the most part, as opposed to elevating, right? So instead of striving, instead of thriving, I should say, we strive. So what's the difference? So striving is, in my opinion, is tiresome. It has a strenuous effort involved in it. Because when a person strive, right, I think I was talking to you earlier about this, sister, we kind of focus on the end result, right? So we only look at the goal. Or maybe it was Sister Morella that I was talking to about it.
Yeah, it was striving and vainglory.
There you go. Did you just come up with that?
No, it's in the Bible. It's a verse. Vainglory.
Hey, can you interrupt me and let me know which verse that is? Because I want to add that here. That's beautiful, sister. Vainglory. And based on what you're saying, because I put down here, striving is like you're putting energy in striving, mm-hmm. but it's laced with negative vibrations. You see? And I think it's mm-hmm. very the same with what you're saying. And this is great verse. I'd like to write that down. And so
when I found it.
Yes, let me know. And thriving, mm-hmm. on the other hand, is, you know, if you look at the word thrive, it's like you think of ever growing, you know, always rejoicing. You know, your energy renewed daily. And you have these forever moments, you know. It's like, what's the difference between striving? I think that thriving, you focus on the day-to-day process to get to your goal, to get to the end result. So the result is not in, you know, it's not the end result that the focus is on, but the growth, the milestones. And while you're looking that up, I wanna put in the verse that was when I was writing this down that was impressed upon my heart. Because my Rish, my daughter turned 13 last week. It was a beautiful week. Mm-hmm. And we had our birthday breakfast. And you know, when my children turn, when we celebrate our birthdays, I love to take the opportunity and just have this one-on-one, zoned in, zero, you know, conversation, right? See, if you look at, like, usually birthdays, right, people... they usually get so enamored and so caught up with, hey, everybody, it's my birthday, let's all celebrate, right? But and there's nothing wrong with that. But to me personally, I take those gem moments and I take, and this is just recently, I've started to take them for a beautiful breakfast and just have a talk, you know, no agenda, let's just have a talk. And Psalm 90:12 comes to mind when I was sharing with my Rish. And I said to her, you know, teach us, this verse says, teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom.
Wow.
You see that? Like, in that verse, that verse kind of is consistent with what we're talking about when it comes to striving and thriving, right? Because, you know, imagine the scripture doesn't say, teach us to, you know, look at our birthdays and just focus on our, like, imagine if we're just focused on our birthdays and we forget about the rest of the 364 days. We only look and pay attention and contemplate, hey, next year, gifts and party, right? But the scripture says days, daily. So there is an emphasis on process, right? Teach us to number our days and why. So the goal is so that we may gain a heart of wisdom, right? So really the difference is, you know, wisdom is when you're doing that process every day, we evaluate, where are we? You know, are we walking in the spirit? Are we operating in fear? Is there a lack of unbelief? Is there doubt? You know, all of these things. And then what happens is this daily immersion of re-evaluation, applying the day-to-day immersion in the word of Yahuah, we really apply this knowledge and it becomes wisdom, right? So what am I saying is the Genesis core story, really, I think that it is where the rest of the details of the scriptures really come from. You know, it's where, like, for example, I believe Brother Shem had mentioned this to me on an offline conversation we had, but even the book of Romans, the very context of it is founded upon Genesis. And I don't think people really see it that way, because a lot of times the book of Romans has been sort of popularized as a, you know, go ahead, sister.
I found the verse.
Oh, you did?
In Philippians 2:3.
Philippians.
It said, nothing be done through strife and or vain glory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves.
Love it. Thank you. I will make sure.
And then there is one in Proverbs 28:25, he that is of a proud heart stirs up strife.
Nice.
But he that puts his trust in Yahuwah shall be made fat. So strife comes together with the vainglory, with pride.
Absolutely. I agree. And it's very, thank you. I have written that down. And when I revisit it, I'll make sure I plug in the actual verse. I've got it right. Philippians 2:3 and Proverbs 28:25, right?
28:25, yes.
Perfect. Thank you. That's awesome. I love it. I love it. Mm-hmm. So we were talking how the Genesis core story, you know, it is a lot of the scriptures is founded upon, like everything is really founded upon to get this one right, right? Mm-hmm. It's kind of like, you know, we talked about it last session we had when we talked about the periodic table. And all of the elements come from one molecule, which is hydrogen. And all of the 117 elements came from that one element, right? Mm-hmm. And if you look at, and I thought that was interesting, because if there's a total of 117, 7 plus 8 plus 1 is 9, and there's 9 gifts of the Ruach. I just love to think about those things. So anyways, for us to just ponder, you know, and again, Genesis is organized in a fashion of a story, right? And, you know, but when you really look into it as a serious student of the scripture, you will notice subtleties and abnormalities of the order of the events, right? So, and here's the other thing too. Why is it that there's only... there's a lack of details, it seems. The content seems to be generalized and small in comparison to the rest of the Bible, you know? And it's like, I've mentioned in the past, I believe that that's intentional. The lack of the specifications and details is purposeful by Yahuah, especially for such a time as this, because I believe that, you know, it gives us... 1 Corinthians 13:9-12. If you look into that, there's this talks about this layers of understanding that the Ruach gives to all, right? We have been given in part, right? And so it says we know in part, right? Actually, let me, I don't know if I wrote that down, but we can go there. So so we know what we're talking about. So what I'm saying is I believe that the Genesis story is written in such a way with limited details because it's a manifestation of 1 Corinthians 13:9, where it says, for we know in part and we prophesy in part, right? But when that which is perfect has come, then that which is in part will be done away. So I think that it is, you know, it is, there's layers and layers of understanding and applications. And instead of debating about it, why, you know, and we don't do that in our forum here, but we're so quick to, you know, to shut down people who, you know, has been studying the scripture and starting to see all these things. And the thing is, it's a, you know, the scripture, there's layers and layers of multicolored interpretations, right? And it really is, I think it just, you know, it challenges us in a way, right? And also we have to remember that 1 Corinthians 2, 4:13 also says that there are some things that needs to be spiritually discerned, right? So this is why I believe that the layer of understanding that we're going to talk about, and I know Brother Shem has a ton of things and a ton of input that he's going to want to, you know, put in here. So that's exciting when he gets a chance to join us next time. Mm-hmm. But it really is it's a pursuit of demystifying the overcomer promise written by Yahusha. This is why we've taken the overcomer promise in Revelation 2, and we're going to demystify that. What does that mean? Right? Why? You know, Philippians 2:13, it is Yah which worketh in us both to will and to do for his good pleasure, right? So when we, right, when we unpack this, and I've written so much that we're going to take our time. I don't want to brush through it we've missed the point. So Revelation 2:7, like, and not just in there, but in general, like when we take this back to Genesis, we will have like a little bit of demystified approach to why this scripture likens us to trees. It makes a beautiful poetry, but then why? And you will be amazed as to why. And why, and if you take careful note, you'll notice that Eden, remember Eden is an enclosure, right?
Mm-hmm.
It only has trees in there, if you really pay attention to it, right? And the location of the tree, the trees, this is important for us. And why is this so important for us? Because out of this understanding, we see Yahuwah's pursuit of love to mankind. And he is just, and he has always wanted to elevate us. It's amazing. He puts us, he is so loving. And when we see this, and this is kind of the purpose, right? That this is the intent behind why I'm writing this stuff, right? 1 John 4:8, you know, it says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Because why? The scripture says fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. You see that? Mm-hmm. So John is talking about there is this process that I believe we are all, this is part of the sanctification walk that we are journeying in, that there's a process of making us perfect in love. And when we look at the story of Genesis, you will see the pursuit of Yahuah, and this is what he was doing, right? And you will see the free will that Eve had, and you will see what happened and why things happened. So it's going to be so awesome, but we're going to take our time because, you know, there's a lot here, right? And I thought that this was interesting. I plugged this in here because if we look towards the end of the scripture, you're going to see that same tree of life in the beginning, right? And I thought that this was interesting. Look at this. In the middle of its street on either side of the river was the tree of life, bearing 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit every month and the leaves. So, wow, look at that. Like, you know, I never, I just thought that that was interesting. Again, you see, the details are generalized because, you know, we have been created by Yahuah with such, we are intelligent beings. We have been given the freedom to think, to imagine. So look at the artist rendering of this scripture. I think it's beautiful, right? We're not saying that this is exactly what it is, but I think it's a layer, it's a glimpse of what the Ruach has put in this, you know, whoever did this beautiful thing, right? So the other thing too about Genesis, if you look at the, from the construct of that word, you know, genes, you know, genes is, wow, this is us basically. So we should be paying attention and I'll show you a little bit of, we are going to do, as you know, that I always like to do, we're going to show some biology behind this to show you how amazing Yahuah is, how he reveals himself in the small things and in the big things. So, you know, I'm not going to go in here because just to get it out of the way to show you where my position is on the creation account. I do see that there's two separate accounts of creation. And I do detail that. I've detailed that in the past. So if your interest is being sparked at this moment and you're like, what are you talking about? well, I'm not going to have the time, nor this is not the forum for me to unpack that. But we did do a video on this, and it is in the YouTube channel, Yahuah Our Delight. You're going to see there's a session there called Promise to the Overcomer Part 3. And it's a ruler over nations. At about maybe 20, 30 minutes, I start going into, you know, like comparison mode as to the order of creation and why there seems to be two separate accounts of creation, right? And I detail a little bit of that here. So, you know, just the subtlety in the differences, right? You're going to see that there. And also, you know, Eve and Adam and Eve, they were put in this Eden, this paradise, this enclosure. So they're pretty special people. They are set apart. And, you know, set apart in what way? And we can simplify it in the three piece, which I have before you. It's the placement, the place they were at, the personhood, you know, Adam, right? And the position, the officehood, you know, and he's the first Malki Zadik, right? He seems to be the only one specifically that Yah breathed the spirit of the Creator upon his nostrils. He's, if you're strict about the text, he's the only one that the scripture says, and the spirit of the Ruach was breathed upon Adam's nostrils. And if you're strict about that, you're going to see that it was only him. So, and you're going to, and it's amazing how that parallel, you can parallel that all the way through the scripture when it comes to the Malki Zadik understanding, right? Basically, the Malki Zadik is the priest of the Most High, right? So Yahuah has tasked, there's always this representative of him, right? Also, why is it, you know, the two creation story, why do I kind of go that way? Because it kind of also talks about, we know that, I think it's in Matthew 6, where, you know, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You see that? So I see that before the fall, heaven and earth, they were in harmony. And then after the fall, something's happened, right? So that harmonious arrangement was severed. And that's why, you know, Yahusha teaches us how to pray. May your will be done, right? On earth as it is in heaven. So that means if you really pay attention to what that scripture is saying, Yahuwah's will is not always being done on earth, right? And then, so what else? Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, he talks about there's celestial bodies and terrestrial bodies. There's natural and there's spiritual body, right? He says the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam became a living, life-giving spirit. And then he says, spiritual is not first, but the natural, and afterward, the spiritual. So there's this earthly and heavenly tabernacle, right? And, you know, and so this is kind of why, if you're wondering where, why, what's the intent behind the two creation story, this is kind of where I'm coming from. Because we have to understand that there was a point where heaven literally was on earth. And Adam and Eve was enclosed. They were enclosed and they were being protected almost. They were set apart from who? From what? Right, is the question. So, and you know what? It, you know, the scripture also talks about Isaiah 11:9 and Habakkuk 2:14, where it says, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of Yahuah as the waters cover the sea. Wow. And then in Ephesians 1:22, he puts all things in subjection under his feet and gave him as head over all things to the assembly, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. So there is this, what I'm trying to, I put that verse before you, and you're going to see now where I'm going to take you as to why Yahuah has this plan. He has this plan that's going to come to pass. Because Prophet Isaiah and Habakkuk says, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of Yahuah as the waters cover the sea, right? And at the same time, right, he, you know, in Ephesians, Yahusha, right, everything has been put under his feet. And he was the head over all things to the assembly. And then it's talking about his body now, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Okay? So what are we trying to say here? I believe that Yahuah, and this is why I'm going to show you this video, because I'm going to invite you to imagine with me in a second, right? Yahuah has this cunning, this beautiful ability, I shouldn't say cunning, but this beautiful ability to reveal himself to us in the macrocosm and microcosm. So if you break down that word, macro simply means large, micro means small, right? Cosm, mm-hmm. from the word cosmos, means order or world, ordered world. So the reason why I'm saying that, because I'm going to invite you to imagine something with me shortly, but Yahuah reveals himself in the largeness of things and in the smallness of things. Okay, so we talked about this past Shabbat, actually, sister, and I was, my kids, you know, my girls, I sort of proposed this, tried to get them to understand what I'm trying to say. But what I did was I took them to John 17:21, right? So look at this. In John 17:21, it says that they all may be one as you, Father, are in me. This is Yahusha speaking. This is the special prayer that he did to Heavenly Father, to Father, his Father. And it's with regards to this special group of people, right? So Yahusha is saying that they all may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. And the glory which you gave me, I have given them, that they may be one just as we are one. What does he mean by that? He says, I in them and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. So my question is, how is it possible? And I presented this to my girls. I said, can I be, okay, well, the question was, can Rihanna be in me? Well, at one point, Rihanna's my youngest, right? At one point, she was in my womb, right? So yeah, it's possible. She was in me. But then how can I be in Rihanna? Like, think about that. Is that even possible? Like, you know, so, and there's other, you know, you'll see other teachers and, you know, people have their interpretation of this. And I'm not saying that that's wrong, but sometimes these kinds of things, we don't admit it because we don't want to be called up upon, or we don't want to be labeled as, oh, you're questioning things. Just this is how it is. But like, how, why would Yahusha say this? And how is he just being poetic? You know, is there something else that is really going on that's amazing? And I believe that there is, there's something that can be understood that just will blow your mind, right? But again, how is it possible that Yahusha in us, and Yahuah in Yahusha, and, you know, do you see the point I'm talking about? And all of us in them, right? It's like, how can one be in one and one in the other one, right? So it's kind of a confusing thing, right? If you look at it like that. Okay, so what I'm talking about here is Yahusha is talking something about revealing something about himself that is in the microcosm. What do I mean by that? If you look at Ephesians 1:22, you know, Paul says something that is it's amazing if we really understand what he's talking about. He says that Yahusha is the head over all things to the church, which is his body, right? So Yahusha is the head, and the church, us, the assembly, is in his body. And Yahusha, the fullness of Yahusha, fills all in all, right? And then, so that's amazing part. That let's park that for a second. And then Matthew 6:19-21 goes on and says, do not lay treasures on earth, for where your treasure is, your heart there be also. So Matthew is talking about our treasure is in our heart, and he expounds it on, and you know, he uses it, he compares it with earth. You see? Earth and heart, right? Almost similarly spelt, right? You just, so what is it? What is it? And the answer is, we're going to see this a little bit. So in Exodus, right, Moses was given instructions to raise up a tabernacle, and he is to make it according to its pattern that was shown to him on the mountain, and that was going to be Yahuwah's dwelling place on earth. And Paul says that we are the tabernacle of Yahuah, right? So what am I trying to say here? So when we look at things like this, right? Imagine that Yahusha literally is the body. That's what Paul says, right? And he is the head, right? And we, remember, we've been talking about some biology here, and we've mentioned that in our individual cells, our cell sister is a miniature version of us. So if you were to reduce yourself cellularly to a microorganism, and you were, you know, imagine yourself as a cell, everything that you have currently, a cell has, right? So if you look at that from that, if you start to look at that from that perspective, so does that mean that Yahusha's body, literally, we are the cells that make up his body. Right?
Is it anything to do with stem cells, like from a little cell to grow?
Yeah. Well, the thing is, in stem cells are very interesting, because stem cells we know is primarily made in the bone marrow, right? Mm-hmm. And we know that stem cells has the ability to replicate or to turn into whatever it wants. And that's interesting. And I think I mentioned this in the past. Each individual cells, right? And this is, you can do Google search on this. Each individual cells are highly intelligent, very, very intelligent. And it's got everything that you and I have. It's got reproductive system, it's got respiratory, everything. But what happens is each and every one of our cells, so you and I, we are made up of what, 50 to 75 trillion cells, our bodies, right? And what happens is every cell is very intelligently designed, very intelligent. But these cells, when they will give up their intelligence to listen to the central voice, right? So this is a picture of, you know, Yahusha is the head, right? He is the head over all things to the body, which is the assembly. And he's the fullness of him who fills all in all. And when we are to follow him, we are to give up ourselves. We are to die to self so that we can follow, and we can follow him wherever he leads us, or to listen to that central voice. And now it makes sense why, you know, why does Moses was given the tabernacle to raise up on earth, and it is Yahuwah's dwelling place. And at the same time, Paul says, we are the tabernacle of Yahuwah, right? Do you see the play that's going on? So the macro of things, so this body of ours, this world, this earth, is also being used to reveal Yahuwah and his son Yahusha in the micro of things. So the like, for example, Matthew 6 says, do not lay treasures on earth. Earth, we know, is huge. For where your treasure is, your heart will there be also. Do you see that? That play on there. It's like macro, micro, right? And it's like, so now, you know, Yahuwah says, heaven is my throne, earth is my footstool. So there's this macro and micro of things, right? And we are going to get to the part about the tree of life, because it's amazing, okay? But the reason why I give you that background is because I want to show you this short video. And I still remember the doctor that I ended up having an hour conversation with. His name is Dr. Laszlo. And he says to me, and at the time I was still so fresh, you know, for some reason Yahuwah has put in me the desire to learn biology. I can't even understand how that came about. And then at the same time, I was fixated to Genesis, and I didn't know it at the time. So, but there were certain things that I was, you know, seeing, and I reached out to this doctor, and what he says to me, he's a biologist, right? So he says to me, oh yeah, like when he is teaching his lessons, his lectures in the university, he uses the scriptures. And and not only that, he says, yeah, you know, when you read Genesis chapter 1 and 2, and the creation account, basically, he says it's basically biology. He's so convinced, and he's so amazed at it. And his colleagues are too. And he says to me, you know, I have some Jewish friends, when we do Shabbat together, this is what we talk about. But he says, this man, he is so on fire. When I was talking to him at the time, and this was probably a year and a half ago, he says to me, I want to write the scripture. He wants to rewrite the scripture and use, like, you know, science term, like terminologies and stuff. And the intent behind this, because he wants to reach his colleagues, right? He says, you know what? What the science community is saying and what the word is, the Christian community is saying, is practically the same thing. It's just lingo is different. So there's miscommunication. People think that they're against each other, but they're not, right? Mm-hmm. And we're talking about modern science here, right? But like, I know there was a movement in that kind of talked about, like, the Darwinism and, you know, like all these evolution stuff. But we're talking modern science. Modern science is finally catching up to what the scripture has been saying all along. So, and it's so close to each other. It's so easily understandable, sister, that even myself, who's a layman, who has no background to any of this stuff, when I'm seeing things, I see the parallels in the scripture when I'm looking at our biology. And like I said, if anything, it really just gives glory to Yahuwah, right? It does demystify things a little bit, gives us a little bit more understanding, right? So
Galatians 2:20.
Yes. I think you're gonna
go. I have been crucified with Yahusha, the Messiah. Yes. It is no longer I who live, but Yahusha who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of Yahuwah, who loved me and gave himself for me.
Hallelujah.
Like you were talking about John before, as you know, he lives in us and we in him, and you know, to be one
in the flesh, which I now live in the flesh. Isn't that amazing? And wow, this is all going to come together. But you know, the other part that I thought I wrote it down, there is a part where you know, Paul says, I, you know, some people are in the ears, you know, that part, where was that, Matthew? Oh, I think Yahusha was the one who was talking about that. You know, I am the body. Some people are the ear, some are the eyes. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. And the yeah.
So
yeah,
again, it's consistent with what we are trying to express here, right? I think I'm going to see if I can find it. I think that's in, I thought I wrote that down, but Yahusha was the one, I think, that was talking about that, or Paul, right? Like, you know, some of us are the eyes and the ears, right? And the eyes will not do away with the ears. You know what I'm talking about, right? So, you know, we really do make up, literally, like Yahusha. So do you think that Yahusha is just talking about some colorful picture, or is he actually, you know what, when he says you in, I in them, and you in me, and all of these things, like what you just quoted as well earlier, right? So there's some beautiful picture that we can kind of be rest assured with, that we are so tucked away, safe in our Yahusha, you know, and we are this part of this, almost this universe, this or this, like the like-minded, like people, his set apart people, the redeemed is also part in his body, right? So now we're going to look at this embryology versus neurology. So embryology is really how a single-celled organism is designed. So basically, when a baby is conceived, this is how the multiplication of the cells happen, right? So and this is the relationship between the structures that make up our organs, basically. Because remember, we are made up of trillions of cells, right? Now, neurology is the field of study of the nervous system. So this is the basis of our learning, our memory, our perception, our consciousness, and is crucial to the development of an embryo. So these two things, right, they are very critical. They're good. They're good to see. It's amazing to watch them. So the nervous system, the primary function of the nervous system is to collect, to process, and to respond to internal and external sensory inputs. So it has to do with transmissions of impulses or communication between cells. So if you look at the embryology and neurology, the way I'm trying to show you now, I'm going to show you the video, is embryology seems to be the creation of the universe, right? And you're going to see that in a bit. And neurology seems to be the creation of Eden, right? That enclosed, set apart placement purpose where the Yahuah is getting the Malkizadik ready to go out and represent him, okay? And so I'm going to play this video, but there's a couple things, right? In you're going to see the word zygote or single cell. And look at this. This zygote or single, this word zygote is from the Greek word yoked, to join, right? Yahuah, the Father, the Son, and the Ruach HaKodesh. I just wrote that down. And then you're going to see a separation of the single cell into two and then four. And it's going to be consistent with the Genesis 1 account. Okay.
Wow. So what,
yes, go ahead, sister.
I just remember
a thing
on somebody that it was first Adam.
Yes.
And then he made Eve. So from one, it got into two.
That's right.
And then the two of them became one again.
Yes.
You know, when Yahuah said that the husband should leave his mother and father and become one with his wife.
Yes.
And so it was Yahuah, Elohim, right?
Yes.
And he sent Yeshua, the Messiah, so they became two from one. Because God is one, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And then, you know, it was a son, the first begotten son, and he went back to the Father and they are one again.
Wow, beautiful. Isn't that, that's just a beautiful picture. And that's exactly what I mean. What you're saying there, that structure, that nature, that the way things are, it is manifesting in our bodies moment by moment.
Mm.
Our cells are multiplying all the time, right? Remember we talked last time, you know, within a year, you are a completely new you, because every single part of you has just has renewed, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to try to, there's just a few things that I want to bring to your attention. Maybe what I'll do is I'll pause and I'll come back to the notes so that we can. Okay, so I'm going to play this video now. This is a video of a fertilized egg, zygote.
Fertilization. The fertilized egg, or zygote, begins dividing. By about 4 days after fertilization, a solid ball of cells called a morula forms. The cells continue to multiply, and by day 5, the cells separate into two groups, the inner cell mass, which will become the embryo, and an encompassing sac called the trophoblast, which will develop into the placenta. Trophoblast cells secrete fluid, creating a cavity, the blastocele, with the inner cell mass at one end.
So just pause that for a second. So inner cell, to me, I see that the earth, and this is why, you know, invite you with the imagination, right? Earth and everything that comes from it. The grass, the trees, the trophoblast or the placenta provides oxygen and nutrients to your growing baby and removes waste products from your baby's blood. See the fluid-filled cavity. Like I see that in this little bit of setup here. But we'll keep going.
At this stage, the mammalian embryo is called a blastocyst. The cells of the inner cell mass eventually form two layers, the epiblast and the hypoblast. The epiblast is thought to contain the cells that will generate the actual embryo.
That's what I mean, yeah, hypoblast.
Critical to the early development of all vertebrate embryos is the process of gastrulation, which occurs between days 13 and 19. Gastrulation results from the movement of cells toward the midline and then forward along the midline, forming a groove called...
Okay, pause that. I know it's hard to imagine. I have to kind of share where my thoughts are going, right? So he's talking about epi, right? He said epi. Let me go back to that one. Epi, right? And then there's the hypo, and there's this fluid-filled cavity. Epi in Greek means above, on, upon. This one will become the embryo, the dust of the earth, right? Hypo means under, beneath. It's like, remember that separation of waters in one place, right? And then the seas, that fluid filled, the deep, right? And if you look at, I think I had here this little bit of, Shem would kind of appreciate this a little because I think he's seen this before, but this is a rendition of, remember we were talking about this, sister, when just simply by reading the text, you know, this is kind of how the earth looks, not in, you know, just by reading the text. And I just thought that it was interesting, the similarities in here, right? In this blastocyst. So if you look at the you know, the Genesis 1 account and the creation of it, you're going to see, you know, there seems to be this water, you know, this firmament that separates the water from above, from water below. And there's this separation here, right? And there's this deep, there's abyss, the Sheol here. And I just thought that that was quite interesting, okay? And what the video goes on and talks about gastrulation. That's the interesting part. So gastrulation begins when the cells, and if you look at the cells, you, right, or your soul, move into this interior of the embryo or the earth suit, right? So that's what gastrulation is. It is when cells move into the interior of the embryo, or think of it as the earth suit. And the primitive streak happens, okay? Primitive streak. Now let's just 19. Show you a little bit of the primitive
streak. Gastrulation results from the movement of cells toward the midline and then forward along the midline, forming a groove called the primitive streak.
So I paused the primitive streak here a little bit, because if you look at the primitive streak, it is what it is. It's like a momentary voltage or frequency. And the transient structure whose formation happens on the day 15 of human development, right? And I put 15 divided by 3 because, you know, Adam was made on day 3, I believe, equals 5, which symbolizes Yahuwah's grace, goodness, and favor toward Adam. So the way I see this little streak, sister, is Yahuwah's hand. Remember when he descended and he formed Adam from the dust of the earth, right? And he formed him, he breathed upon him the breath of life, and he became a living being, right? I see this primitive streak as his little finger, his little hand, because what happens right after this primitive streak is the formation of the embryo.
The end result is the production of the three primitive cell layers, the endoderm, the mesoderm, and the ectoderm. The nervous system develops from the outer layer called the ectoderm. As this cell layer thickens, it becomes a distinct epithelium called the neural plate.
Okay, I'm going to pause there for a second, okay? I wrote here that this primitive streak that you see, this little kind of momentary, or this split in the middle of that thing that you saw, it marks the start of gastrulation. So what is that? This is the process where the inner cell mass in converted into the, so this trilaminar embryonic disc. What is that? That is the part where you see the layers, the three germ layers, the ectoderm, mesoderm, and endoderm. Okay, so this is a representation of the ectoderm is the spirit, the type of spirit. Mesoderm is the body, and endoderm is, So ectoderm is the spirit, mesoderm is the body, and endoderm is the soul. I think that's what I have it there. And what happens is, I'll show you what I have here. Okay, here we go. So Yahuah Elohim, right? He made us into a three-part being, body, soul, spirit. Ectoderm is a representation of Yahuah the Father. Why? Because the brain, the spinal cord, is made from the ectoderm, right? This is where our main mind works out of, where the spirit is housed, right? Mesoderm, right, in that three germ layer, mesoderm is a representation of Yahusha, because mesoderm is where heart is made up from, right? So remember, we talk about heart and the earth, right? Endoderm is the representation of the Ruach HaKodesh, because this is where the lungs is made from, right? And the neural plate is like Eden, and the neural groove is like the garden. Okay, hold on, let me show you that. And I'll show you what I mean.
Uneven rates of cell division form a groove called the neural groove that will become the midline of the embryo. Ridges of ectoderm continue to bulge on both sides of the midline. The tops of the neural ridges eventually come together, forming the neural tube. The interior of the neural tube becomes the fluid-filled cerebral ventricles of the brain.
What does that remind you of, sister? That little enclosure there. Doesn't that remind you of the garden? Enclosure, right? And let me see if it goes on.
The canal of the spinal cord and the passages that connect them. By about 24 days, the three major subdivisions of the brain are discernible. These include the prosencephalon, or forebrain,
So we're going to talk about that in at a later time. But I just wanted to, you know, I wanted to sort of share where the neural groove, the neural plate, the neural groove, that groove that turns into this enclosure, right? And the neural tube, I see as the tree of the knowledge of good and evil that covers the central nervous system consisting of the brain and the spinal cord, is referred to as the central because it combines information from the entire body and coordinates activity across the whole organism, connective force or the tree of life. That was my note here. And the neural tube is here, and it talks about the precursor to the central nervous system. And it goes on and talks about the telencephalon. This is where the neocortex is formed from. Tele meaning far, far off, operating over distance, right? Diencephalon gives rise to that paleocortex that we were talking about. And the mid and the hind brain is the lower part of the brain. And we talked about in the past that the three parts of the brain, right? So this is the start of neurogenesis. And this is like that in this part, this is like the stem cell that we were talking about early. The stem cell has a tendency to differentiate into a specific type of cell, right? So, you know, let me see here. Eve or progenitor, that's what you call it, progenitor in Latin, meaning forth or to produce, to beget, okay? So it's interesting also that father in Hebrew means Ab, or in Greek means patar, it means ancestors and generator, right? So neurogenesis, the breakdown of that word, right? Adam, right? Type of man. Eve, the mother of all living. Mother in Hebrew means point of departure or division. So, and I know it might be a little bit too much here to talk about, but I wanted to quickly go into the neurogenesis because this is where I'm going to take the tree of life eventually, okay? So neurogenesis, new, basically, okay, new, N-E-U, the root word new means to shout, okay? It forms all or part of announce, right, denounce, ambassador pronouns, or messenger in Latin. So when what we were looking at earlier is the embryology, right, where sort of like Genesis 1 was happening. And then neurology is where Adam and Eve is starting to be pointed out to be put into this Garden of Eden. So that's neurology. So this is why I'm going into neurogenesis now, because now we're going to talk specifically about Adam and Eve, right? And I thought that it's interesting that the word, even in the word neurogenesis, you're going to see the word new, right, as a messenger. So I believe Adam and Eve was a messenger towards the outside world, outside of Eden, right? Even if you look at the word neuron, right? Neuron, again, we talked about new as in messenger, right? Ron, if you look at the Hebrew name Aaron, the derivation suggests it means high mountain or exalted. So it's like Adam, you know, is set apart. He is in a high mountain, or I would call it heaven on earth, right? Genes, okay? If we look at genes, genes are made up of DNA, and our DNA basically contains instructions. And for this to be functional, right, our DNA has everything. Remember when Paul says we have been given everything that pertains to life and set apartness? This is a picture of our DNA because our DNA has everything already in there. But for it to be functional, it needs to be expressed, right? So it's like you have to, literally, it's like opening a book. You have to open the book, the instructions within your DNA, and read it. And for it to be read, it's basically copied into the RNA. And once that's done, this is what creates the templates, the proteins to perform certain functions. So it's just so, you know, it's so consistent with the neurogenesis, the neurons, the genes, you know, neuron, new messenger, neuron, you know, a set apart position, genes that has instructions, right? So that's neurogenesis, right? So what is neurogenesis? It's the process by which messages are formed in the brain, in that enclosure, during the embryonic development. So before the fall, look at that, but also continues in certain brain regions after birth and throughout our lifespan. So this is the meaning of neurogenesis. Again, neurogenesis is the process by new neurons, by which new neurons or messages are formed in the brain, and think of the brain as an enclosure, right? During the embryonic development or during the creation of the world, before the fall, right? There's neurogenesis happening. There was Adam and Eve being put into this Garden of Eden. But it doesn't end there. Neurogenesis also continues in other brain regions and after birth and throughout the lifespan of a human being. So to me, I just find that it's so key. You can see that even in the makeup of our brain, our embryology in our brain, Yahuah is already showing you some beautiful things about the scripture. Okay. So again, we're going back to Adam, right? Adam is the first Malkizadi. So he was a Malkizadi on purpose. He was a messenger. He was like, if you look at Adam, you can compare him to a neuron, right? So what does a neuron look like? Okay. So here's a picture of a neuron. So look at this neuron right here. You're going to see that it kind of looks like a tree, doesn't it? See? And look at the construct of this neuron, okay? You see this little, the little dot inside here, right? So inside this little face here, that is called a soma. Soma is basically a body. If you look at the Greek word for soma, is body. Inside the body is a nucleus, right? So that little dot there is a nucleus. Now, the tree-like structures that sits on top of the soma, these ones right here, these are dendrites. These are the tree-like structures. And this here, this sort of branch, or you call it, I guess you would call it branch or stem, it is called an axon. And how close is that to the word action? And I'm going to explain how amazing this is. Now, the bottom part here are called nerve endings, okay? So these little things are called neurons. And if you want to look at how they look like when they're put together, this is how it looks like in our brain. So in the biggest part, the biggest tissue in our brain has all of these tree-like structures. So they're like neurons, okay? So how it works is this, okay? This is, I'm going to see if I can explain this in such a way where it's so amazing in my mind. But sister, do you remember in Genesis 2, Yahuah says, out of the ground, Yahuah Elohim made every tree grow that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, right?
Yeah.
And you look at, right? And you look at this structure like neuron, or if you look at them, they're in the brain. And it's kind of like Adam. It's kind of like a representation of Adam. And I'll show you why, okay? So let me see here. If I can make this bigger a little bit, because I'm going to show you something. So these little things talks about something so beautiful. And now all of our memories, you know, all of our experiences from birth right? When these tree-like structures, the dendrites, these are basically cluster of thoughts or memories that we have accumulated since birth. So we, like these structures, these dendrites, they change all the time. So right now, as we're having this conversation, right, the information that you're receiving, right, will sweep through the tree-like structures that you have in your brain, sort of like a wind. Imagine it like a wind, and it will it's like a breeze. It will go through as a breeze, and it will activate or it will move these tree-like structures in your brain. Okay, so when information is presented before you, right, it touches these dendrites, right, and what happens is you are formulating a cluster of thoughts, and you're basically going to make a decision based on the information that you're getting from the external input that you're getting and the internal input or the memories that you have already built. So some of this stuff that I'm talking about right now, it's foreign to you. So you've not had, dendrite structures that can relate to it. So it's probably just kind of like coming through and you're not making connections. But when I start talking about like Adam, right, like how he was set apart, how he's put in this enclosure, and he's kind of like a neuron, because look at this neuron, right? It looks like a tree. And, you know, and we are likened. The scripture likens us as trees. When I say something like that, you've read for yourself Psalms 1. You've read for yourselves that, you know, we are like trees replanted by the river's water, right? So when I say things like that, then that kind of makes connections in your brain, right? So all of these things will connect with other dendrite or other branches. Because remember, there's thousands, there's billions of these. I shouldn't say thousands. And when these dendrites, they are connected, like you see this nerve endings, they connect these dendrites here, they connect to this nerve endings, okay? So what happens is this, right? So when information from the external is received by your brain, by your mind, it goes through like a breeze and it touches all of these dendrites in our mind, in our brain. And what happens is, based on that, when you make connections, you make choices, right? The choices that you have. So all of these things, you are presented with a number of probabilities, right? You can choose to tune out. You can choose to do some further studies. You can do whatever. It's your choice, right? But whatever you choose, you will act upon. So these dendrites, it's like it represents the number of probabilities that you have before you based on the memories that you have built over time, right? Based on the memories that you have built. And what happens is, based on that, you will make a decision. So once you make a decision, guess what happens? It travels through this axon. So this is your action potential, right? So all of these probabilities collapses into reality when it hits this part. And that's when the communication ends up getting sent out to the nerve ending. And then what happens is it communicates all throughout the rest of your body, right? And so this is, I don't know if you see how beautiful this is, but to me, I see this as, you know, when Moses says, I present before you, I set before you life and death, right? If you choose life, you will be blessed, right? If you choose death, there's curses that come with it, right? So the way I see this is a representation of our that's in our mind, that's in our brain, that shows us how thoughts are processed in our brain. and how choices come about and how we make choices based on the thoughts that we get, right? Does that make sense to you? Kind of. Let me see if I can and go back to that and
yeah, I was muted, so.
Yes. So here's the interesting part, okay? You know how in the Garden of Eden, right? There are some studies that this is called Cited from the Barren Temple and the Withered Tree. So this is a book. And it's also cited in the Apocalypse of Moses. So according to them, the leaves of all the trees said to have withered as soon as Eve had eaten of the forbidden fruit, except for the fig tree, which is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And that was what supplied Adam and Eve with their covering. Okay? So in other words, before the fall, all the leaves, all the trees in the garden was beautifully, it had leaves, full of leaves, right? And fruits probably, right? But as soon as Eve had taken part of that forbidden fruit, they believe, these sages, they believe that the leaves withered, okay? So
when Eve took the fruit, or when Adam?
When Eve took the fruit, because we're going to get to Adam in a bit, but when Eve, mm-hmm. this is according to the book that I came across with, this mm-hmm. is what they were saying, that Eve, after she ate, then the trees, the leaves of all the trees wither. So I want to show you something here. In comparison, this is like what I guess you would call fall and spring, right? Or summer. Mm-hmm. So this is a picture of a tree that has no leaves that have withered. And this is a picture of a tree that's healthy and that's not dormant, right? And look at, this is a picture, you've seen this before. This is a brain image, a scan of your brain with all of these dendrites, this trees that is all over the gray matter in your brain, right? And it kind of, right now, it doesn't look like it's this tree right here, doesn't it? Kind of looks like that. Mm. Even if you look at the dendrite, it looks like there's no leaves. And I think this is a result of the fall. I believe that because of the fall, we have lost a huge chunk of our effectiveness, of our consciousness with Yahuah. Remember, Adam had full consciousness with Yahuah because he was given the spirit of the Ruach, of Yahuah himself, right? So, and then now if you look at Revelation 22, Revelation 22 says what? The tree of life. Because if you look at Revelation 22, it says it will bear 12 fruits, and each tree yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. Look at that. And if you look, if you jump back into Genesis, you're going to notice that there's really no mention of the fruit of the tree of life, right? There really was no mention. I mean, Eve partook of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, but there's no mention of the tree of life. And we will see why. But the point I'm saying right now is this tree-like structures we have in our brain, in our gray matter, it's very similar to a tree that looks like it has no leaves. And according to sages, after Eve had partaken of that fruit, all of the leaves withered, except for that tree of the knowledge of good and evil, right? And so I think that that's so interesting. And then you jump back to Revelation 22, you're going to notice that all of a sudden, there's leaves in the tree of life. So I guess where I'm going is, you know what? Is it possible that this is the glorified state of who we will be? You know, right now, we have this, and we've talked about this in the past, we have our consciousness, the conscious part of our mind is only less than 5%, sister. Like, you know, 2 or 3%. We were talking about this. So a huge chunk of that, more than 95%, is non-conscious or subconscious, right? And so this is why the scripture is majority of the scripture, I believe, is sanctification, right? It is geared towards the journey of us going back to the what it's like to be in that full oneness with Yahuah that Adam and Eve had, right? So and I'll see if I can explain this a little better, but this picture right here, this dendrite right here, this gives us understanding on how thoughts formulate in our brain and how those thoughts become clusters of thoughts and how those clusters of thoughts become basically the energy that fuels our choices, right? So I'll give you an example. In our mind, so I want you to kind of, so envision your brain, and you have all of these tree-like structures. All of these tree-like structures is basically your memory, all of your accumulated thoughts, right? So when, let's say as a young child, you had a poor childhood, right? You had a childhood that, you know, that you were neglected or whatever it is. So a big chunk of your childhood would have formulated this tree-like structures in your mind, right? And I'll show you that in a bit later on. But what happens is when we grow older, when we become older, we don't realize that a big chunk of our decisions, the way we react to things, is based on the way our structures, our architecture of our brain was formulated when we were young. So what Paul is saying when he's talking about, you know what, whatsoever is pure, whatsoever is good report, right? Whatsoever is true, whatsoever is praiseworthy, think on these things. You know what Paul is doing, basically? He's teaching us how to no longer, or how to make the tree-like structures in our brain that is not of Yahuah, to don't nurture them. These tree-like structures, if you don't add nurturing to them, eventually it will go away and it will disappear, right? So Paul wants us to invest and nurture into good thinking. This is what Philippians 4:7 is about, right? He wants us to think on these things, because what happens is the more you think about, the more you accumulate good clusters of thoughts, the more this tree-like structure grows, right? And it, because you have this healthy tree, imagine a healthy forest of trees in your mind, that you have that every time you are faced with whatever it is that you face in life. All of this is being, it's like, think of it as a breeze that breeze that runs through this forest. And so if that forest-like structure is made up of very good thoughts and clusters of thoughts of Yahuah, the fruit of the Spirit, guess what happens? Your decisions and your reactions, that's how you end up manifesting the fruit of the Spirit, right? So right now, this will take work. This is the sanctification that we all must do, because we have to recognize that because of the fall, there is a big difference in the way our tree-like structures in our brain is structured. Does that make sense? Right? And that's why here on this slide, it says, Your mind is like a forest of trees, and you are the one who decide its design, right? So this is kind of where, this is kind of why we are facing this sanctification journey that we all have to embark on. So if you look at the mapping of the metaphors that the scripture uses from the beginning, okay, remember we are a three-part being, right? We are body, soul, spirit. Look at the consistency of the metaphors that the scripture uses. The land of Eden, the garden, and then there's that midst in the garden, that midst of the garden or the tree of life, right? In the tabernacle, there's the outer court, the holy place, the holy of holies. You know, Yahushua says he is the way, the truth, and the life, right? Paul says that there is a witness on earth that Yahushua gave us. That is blood, water, spirit. We are body, soul, spirit. Look at this. Faith, hope, and love, right? And, you know, we have not been given the spirit of fear, but what of power, of love, of power, of sound mind? You see how there's this consistency in metaphors or in addressing the three-part man. So here's what I believe, right? Before the fall, right, it was supposed to be love. So Yahuwah was perfecting Adam and Eve in love. Because what happens is when they are perfected in love, they become that hope and they represent the faith of the righteousness of Yahuwah. And so that they're going to go to the rest of the day six people to preach the righteousness of Yahuwah. That's what I believe the original plan is. Now, after the fall, it just, there's a little bit of work to be done, maybe a lot. So now it's reversed. Now, in order for us to get to the perfected love that Paul was talking about, right, we have to enter into faith through Yahusha. So, and through that faith, we increase our hope, our expectation. And that journey brings us always in love. Always. We always, when we go through this step, when we go through faith, hope, and love, the way, the truth, the life, we apply the blood, water, the spirit, we apply all of these beautiful constructs. This is why the scripture says we have been given everything and literally everything, because Yahuwah is love, right? So if we are made in his likeness and in his image, then that means we are made from his love. We are made out of love. And what does that make us? We are love, right? So what's amazing about the way our biology is made up of is that everything about us, sister, the functions, everything about ourselves, its functions, its job, the way it operates, it is designed in love, right? And so, you know, in Genesis, it starts off that way, right? And if you look at the end, it's also going to end in love, right? And if you look at 1 Corinthians 13, if you look at the construct of this, the letter that Paul talks about, because he really will, he'll talk about love, right? If you look at the construct of this chapter, it starts off with love, right? He's saying, you know what, though I speak with the tongues of man, right, and of angels, but have not love, I have become a sounding brass or a clinging cymbal, right? So he talks about, you know, if I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries, I have all faith and I could move mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And then he goes on and talks about love. What is love? And then if you look at the end of it, you see how, but, and now abide faith, hope, love. These three, the greatest of this is love. You see how, you know, Paul starts off with love and he ends adjudicating for love, right? And so everything about our bodies is made out of love. The way our minds work, the way our intellect is processed. But what happens is when we are operating in fear, right? So in a nutshell, because we are made out of love and we are designed for love, when we operate in fear, we actually introduce and create chaos in our cellular environments, including our mind, our brains, everything about it. And this is what Dr. Leaf is so good at trying to communicate, right? She communicates that, listen, you know, when you operate in love, this is what happens in your cells, in your bodies. This is how your mind works. This is how your neocortex works with your paleocortex and all these things. But when you, the minute you operate in fear, right? The minute you do that, the body doesn't know what to do with that. So it's like, oh, what am I, you know, it's not designed like that by Yahuah. So what happens is it will start to throw things out of, you know, proportion, out of whack. It'll be chaotic inside our bodies. And this is basically why we have to guard our heart. This is why we need to immerse ourselves and learn how to focus on thinking, just like what Philippians 4:7 says, right? You want to share something about that, sister?
No, I'm fine.
Great.
I'm enjoying the exposition.
Praise Yahuah. And this is where, because you know how we're talking about 1 Corinthians 13, right? How it's kind of a sandwich approach, right? Like Paul starts with the love top bun, and then he ends with the bottom bun love, right? But he talks about that in between. But he does something that is so amazing here. He talks about 1 Corinthians 13:11. He says, when I was a child, I spoke as a child, right? I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. And then he says, for now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I also am known. So I take this is going to be the segue to the next session that we're going to have, because Paul talks about, I think he puts this in here very, very strategically and very wisdom. There is wisdom as to why he puts this construct here. So he's talking about, so first of all, he says, for now we see in a mirror, right? Dimly, he says. Remember we talked about how this tree-like structures in our brain seems to look like literally like a fall tree, right? Like there's no leaves, right? Mm. And it talks about, because of that, right? You know, science tells us that we don't have full consciousness. We have a very big, large part of us that is non-conscious. So you and I are talking right now, and we are operating in conscious mind, right? So this is, you know, sister, this is why I need to write it down. Because when I write down, so if I were to talk to you without my notes, I'm operating in my conscious mind. So do you think I'm going to have all of this information ready to speak to you? Probably not. And some people over time, you know, because they've mastered what they're teaching, they can probably do that. But it's different when I sit down, right? And I write this down. All of this is coming from a non-conscious part, and I'm able to bring it to the surface a little bit more. And then I write it down so that I don't forget. So you see, you and I were operating in this part on, you know, we see in part, right? We know in part. We see in the mirror dimly, because after the fall, the tree-like structures in the Garden of Eden, which I believe represents that enclosure, is like, if you want to, for illustration purposes, it's like our brain. And in the brain, in that enclosure, because Adam is like the neurons in our brain, right? He's like a tree, right? So anyway, when the fall happened, all of the leaves withered, So the same thing with the consciousness that we, that Adam had with Yahuwah, right? Because he lost his connection with Yahuwah, right? Mm-hmm. So what happened? See, Paul says something really cool. Look at this. And he says, but then face to face. Do you see how I'm just reversing it? He's saying right now we see in part. We don't have full consciousness with Yahuwah. But then one day we will have face to face. What does that remind you of? Adam, when the Creator came down and you know, formed him from the dust of the earth and he breathed, he had a panim to panim encounter, if that's a word. He had a panim to panim, a face to face with Adam. You see, we're all headed towards that. We saw what it was like with Adam before the fall. And this is why I think it's so good to see what it was like, because we have this, you know, this something that we look forward to, you know, that this is not the way it's going to be all the time. Like this thing that we find ourselves, this cycle of life, is a journey. We are literally a passer. What's the word? We are just passing on, right? We are just journeying this earth. And then we know in part, but then I shall know, just as I also am known. Do you see the wording that Paul is talking about? And you can kind of see the reversal of that in Eden, right? Back then they knew, they had full consciousness. They had a face-to-face encounter with experiential walk with Yahuwah. But because of the fall, we don't have that right now. But Paul says we are going to go back to that. But he also talks about what it's like to be a child. Do you see this? When I was a child, I spoke as a child and I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. So what is he saying? He's saying that he's basically saying you got to learn how to read in between the lines, right? What Paul is saying, right? What he's saying is our progress, our walk on in the faith, we cannot stay as a child, right? We have to progress with childish things. And so there comes a point in our walk that we are to become a man, to mature in this walk. And when we do that, we put away childish things, right? Mm-hmm. Why is that so important? This is where I want to take us in the next session. Why? Mm-hmm. Because Adam and Eve were like little children in the garden. They were like little children, right? And they had, I don't believe that they were physically like little children. I believe Adam was made into, you know, an adult kind of body, but they, in their mental capacity, in their brain, they are comparable to that of children. And we're going to understand why Paul is like, why is it that Yahuwah wants us to grow? Why is Yahusha coming back for a bride, not for a little girl? Like, we have to understand this stuff, right? So this is the part where I think then we're going to really go into why and why that is, kind of thing. But for now, I just wanted us to see, you know, a little bit of science. And I know there's a lot of like scientific terms that seems to be, we've never, even admittedly so for myself, it's so new to me that I find that I can't even expound it in a way that can be easily understood. I had written it because in my mind, it impressed something in my mind and my spirit that, wow, look at this. This is, you know, we may not have seen what the creation was like thousands of years ago, but we have to see the glory of the way we are made. You know, Yahuwah made us beautifully, fearfully, and wonderfully. And even in the cell divisions that take place, it is a picture of his creation over and over again. This is this is what I mean when I say that Yahuah reveals himself in the macro, right? And as well as in the micro of things, right? So, and why is it so, you know, so like the question is, so what? Why do we want to know that? Well, I don't know about you, but I don't have like a shuttle where I can go out and see the world and the earth and stuff like that, right? So, but how do I appreciate all of that? How, you know, if Yahuah has given us this science, this knowledge, this modern understanding of our biology, because in the same way we can appreciate the creation of Yahuah, we can appreciate it in the micro of things. So in our very bodies, it is a picture of Yahuah's creation. You know, when you look at embryo and how it's formed and how neuro is formed and how the brain is formed and the spinal cord is formed. And it's like, you know, it really is a picture of Genesis 1 and 2. And, you know, and maybe we'll go back to it when we get to that point again, and when the Ruach allows us an opportunity to, you know, to embark on it in a way that we can understand more. But I guess what I'm saying is this right. You know, we talked about the overcomer promise. He that overcomes, he will be granted the right to eat from the tree of life. So right now in our brain, in the fallen state of our brain, and it looks like branches right now. There's no leaves, right? We can't really eat. In other words, there's no leaves in our brain structure. We are a work in progress. This journey that we have, we are being conformed to the image of our Yahusha. So one day, because our sanctification is made complete in Yahusha, we now picture your brain, your tree-like structure in your brain, as opposed to this little no leaves. Picture that with this beautiful tree filled with green leaves, right? And you see, we are given access to eat from that. In other words, we will partake. We will be a part of that. Right now, we are in part, just in part. We are progressing through it. But in the Overcomer Promise, we will be given this face-to-face, panim to panim. We are, once again, sister, I believe we're going to get to full consciousness of Yahuah. This is why this is eternal life, to know Yahuah, right? This is why one day there is no need. You know, where is that? Was that in Isaiah, where Yahusha himself will teach us, right? Like, it's, we're going to enter once again into this full awareness. Right now we are in this dim part, but that's why we have faith, you know, that we have this strong conviction within us that we continue to walk, because in our conviction, in this strong conviction of faith that we have, this is how we manifest heaven on earth, literally, right? And this becomes a reality, right? So this is kind of where my heart was going when I was putting this together. And we have about 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Anything on your mind?
Well, thank you for this. Yes, this teaching. It's a bit much for me, yes. But I could go back.
I know.
Go back and you know, look it over again and take it slowly.
Yes. Honestly, this is same, like, with me. Same with me. I want to go back because there's some things that I want to expound. And you know me, I usually expound a little bit more, right? So will we leave it? We commit these things to Yahuah. But thank you, sister, for your time and attention. I always appreciate you. Thank you for, you know, for letting me, you know, run this by you, you know, and I know a lot of it is foreign, or maybe, but together, it's like eventually we'll be like, oh, the aha moment. Yes, we get it together. It's not just you, me too. You know, all of these things I'm presenting as I'm putting them together, and, you know, some of them are fully realized, some of them are not. But, you know, perhaps those who are watching can see something that I haven't seen, or maybe, you know, and this is what the whole purpose of this is, it's a conversation, right? So
yes. And they could make a note there, a comment.
Exactly, a comment. Yeah. You know,
and like, we all learn.
Because we all know in part, and this is the beauty of it, right? When we come together, it's a beautiful connection. So this is why, you know, just present this information before you. And thank you to those who have also labored with us in this session that we have. Praise Yahuwah. So shall we close in prayer? All right. Oh, Heavenly Father, we just give you all the praise and honor and glory. And even now, Abba, in your presence, there is fullness of joy. And Father, we know that you are working in us, and you are teaching us. Your Ruach is the one who is leading and guiding us unto all truth. So we celebrate, Father, this bit of layer of truth of the scripture. And yes, Father, thank you for the freedom in the spirit to be able to imagine these things and be able to behold the beauty of your creation through our biology. You know, Father, in the scripture, it says we are beautifully, fearfully, and wonderfully made. And you know, and we can stay in the poetic part of that, or we can leverage, we can use the truth of even what science is now starting to uncover, that is really now catching up with what the word of Yahuwah is saying all along. So if anything, Father, for us to just be able to appreciate you, your glory, Abba Yahuwah, and be able to give you glory, and so that we can increase in faith, so that we would be more and more strongly convinced, because we know, Abba, that as faith and understanding increases, expectation within us gets added more and more. This expectation, Father, that increases manifest to manifestation, Father, into what your purpose, your perfect will is for us, Abba Yahuwah. So I thank you for my dear sister who labors with me, and that attention is not free, Abba Yahuwah. So it is a blessing to be able to receive the gift of attention. Father, thank you for my sister, and that you would bless her, and that you would prosper her in whatever she sets her hands to. And the same, Abba, with the Kodeshim, the rest of the community of your people who are in our circle of influence. And Abba, that you would also prosper them in ways that you only can. And so, Father, I thank you once again, and we give you all the praise and honor. Thank you that we will have a beautiful, restored sleep, and we will be productive in our undertakings tomorrow. And all of these things we ask in Yahusha's mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.